Welcome. Thank you all for coming. I am Mike Morey with Standard Insurance Company. I am the current president of the Westside Economic Alliance. Usually, I just pop up here and say those two sentences, and then I sit down and enjoy my breakfast. Unfortunately, today, Pam Treese is not going to be here. Probably part of her master plan, because she's now going to know that we greatly appreciate her presence more than ever. So please, if you run into her in the future, tell her that we want her back and she's never, ever allowed to miss another one of these events. So welcome. This is our breakfast forum, and we are thrilled to have Congresswoman Suzanne Bonamici here. And first and foremost, a very big thank you to Legacy Health for being our presenting sponsor today. And as a matter of fact, Dr. George Brown, the president and CEO for Legacy, is here with us today. Thank you. And I've heard that you are retiring, so special thank you. And thank you for all of your support of the Westside Economic Alliance and for all of you have done for the community. Thank you very much. Once again, this doesn't happen without our sponsors, and we appreciate and are very grateful to Legacy Health for being the presenting sponsor of today's program. So now, I would like to bring up Anderson from our board of directors. Since 2002, Allison has been Legacy Meridian Parks Medical Center's chief administrative officer. Allison, please come on up.
Thank you, Mike. Good morning. On behalf of Legacy Health, it is our privilege to be the presenting sponsor for today's forum. Legacy Health is the Greater Portland area's only locally owned and operated health system. Our facilities include Randall Children's Hospital, Emmanuel, Good Samaritan, Mount Hood, Meridian Park, and Silverton Medical Centers. Our system also includes a comprehensive referral laboratory, hospice, and medical group. At Legacy, we are fully committed to our mission of good health for our people, our patients, our communities, and our world. So that concludes the presenting sponsor portion. It is now really my privilege and pleasure to introduce you to today's speaker, a woman who really needs no introduction, Congresswoman Suzanne Bonamici. Congresswoman Bonamici represents the 1st Congressional District of Oregon, which comprises the northwest portion of our state. Strengthening public education is one of Suzanne's top priorities and one of the reasons she got involved in public service. As a member of the Committee on Education and the Workforce in Congress, she is dedicated to giving educators and students the resources they need to succeed. Suzanne served a lead role in the passage of the bipartisan Every Student Succeeds Act, which replaces No Child Left Behind and creates new K-12 education policies. She's also focused on making college more affordable, close to my heart, I will have two kids in college soon, closing the skills gap. Suzanne is the founder and co-chair of the bipartisan Congressional STEAM Caucus, which aims to encourage innovation and creative thinking by integrating arts and design with science, technology, engineering, and math education. Congresswoman Bonamici serves as a member of the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, and she's the top Democratic member on the Subcommittee on the Environment. From this position, she is working to address the causes and risks of global climate change and to ensure that policy decisions are based on science. Suzanne worked her way through college in Eugene, first at Lane Community College, and then at the University of Oregon, where she earned her bachelor's in law degrees. Suzanne and her husband, Michael, have been married for more than 30 years, and it is my great privilege and pleasure to welcome Suzanne Bonamici.
Thank you so much, Allison, for that kind introduction. Thank you, Westside Economic Alliance, for the opportunity to spend some time with you this morning. Thank you, Legacy, for your sponsorship today, but also for all you do in the community. And again, to Dr. Brown, thank you for your years of service and best wishes for the future. So again, thank you. It's great to be here this morning. Several people have said, isn't it nice to be home and not in Washington, D.C. right now? We have been here in our home in our district since the end of July. We go back to Washington, D.C. the day after Labor Day, and we have a very long list of things that need to get done back in our nation's capital. I have spent a lot of August traveling around talking to people in this great district I'm honored to represent. Washington County is, of course, the heart of the district, but I was in Columbia County yesterday, we'll be in Yamhill County tomorrow. And people are very concerned about what's happening in our country. They have raised a lot of questions about the direction of the country and what we're doing, and I'm looking forward to going back and tackling some of those challenges when we head back after Labor Day. And I thought what I would do this morning is to talk about three sort of key issues and areas that I'm working on and expect to continue working on that I know are important to the Westside Economic Alliance and to this district, but then allow plenty of time because I want this to be a conversation. I want to hear from you and have a dialogue as well. So in that introduction, Allison mentioned my focus on education. It's really what drove me into getting into public policy when excuse me, my own kids went through the Beaverton School District, and I know the potential of public education to give everyone in this country the opportunity to be successful in life regardless of their background, their zip code, their sexual orientation, their race, their religion. So that is a priority of mine, and the federal role in education really came about as part of the Civil Rights Movement back in the 1960s with the Elementary and Secondary Education Act to try to level the playing field and give every child opportunities. And so working on that Every Student Succeeds Act was a real honor to have that opportunity to help get that over the finish line. The Every Student Succeeds Act, which leaves behind no child left behind, puts more focus on well-rounded education, fewer better assessments, and importantly, more decisions being made at the state and local level. No Child Left Behind had this one-size-fits-all approach that wasn't working in our country. So I was happy to get that over the finish line and watching implementation across the country. Oregon is a leader with our educational leadership about implementing that law. College affordability, again, is an important issue for me. I'm in the Education and Workforce Committee. We should be working on the Higher Education Act reauthorization. And there's several things that I've been doing. For a start on the budget, we need more Pell Grants to help low-income students, not fewer Pell Grants. So I'm not in favor of cutting that funding to help low-income students get into school. I've supported a bipartisan approach to improved financial counseling for our students so they have a better sense of their financial obligations and the grant and loan opportunities. That's been a bipartisan work we've been doing. I've been working on a bipartisan work study bill to help more students get work study and to align work study with the students' field of interest and career goals. I also have a bipartisan bill I just introduced before we came home at the end of July to help more student loan borrowers get into income-based repayment and stay in income-based repayment, so fewer of them are in default. So a lot of different pieces there to help with college affordability. I'm also thrilled to announce that the House has passed the Career and Technical Education Bill. It's called the Perkins Act, after a former representative, Carl Perkins. Career and technical education, of course, we know in Oregon is important. We passed a ballot measure. Excuse me. It's that hands-on learning, not your old shop class, like when some of us were going to school, but there's so many great CTE classes now. I know Sherwood has a welding class. St. Helens up in Columbia County has, you know, they build tiny houses, and they have a AAA-certified auto repair shop where they learn how to run a business as well as how to fix cars. Aloha High School has a great auto tech class. And when I visit these programs, Newburgh has a wonderful culinary program. The list goes on and on. Yamhill County, I have to give just a little shout out because they have a viticulture program at their high school. So I guess the only high school in the country with a vineyard. But the point is that they want students to learn the skills they need to work in their local community. And so when we see students who are in these classes, they're really engaged, and it's going to help not only help them be prepared for the jobs that are there, but also keep them in school. And that is so important. I give a little shout out to Wind and Ore, which I know Norm's involved with, a great program where they help students, they go into schools and students build boats. It's a phenomenal program that helps engage students. So the federal bill helps with some funding, especially for things like equipment. Aloha High School at their auto tech program, they have a big piece of equipment. They said, we couldn't buy this without the federal support. So when you see your senators, you might want to mention that you'd join me in wanting them to get that over the finish line on the Senate side. The STEAM caucus, which was mentioned in the introduction, has been a really positive thing to work on. And just briefly, being on the Science Committee and the Education Committee, everyone was talking about STEM and how important science, technology, engineering, and math are. Yes, they're very important. But then when I got out into the real world and talked with employers, they'd say, well, we really want people who can come up with new ideas and work in a team and communicate and find new ways to solve problems. But nobody was talking about how we educate people to be creative and innovative. And the bottom line is the brain research shows you don't cut things like arts and music, because when we're educating both halves of students' brains, they are more creative and more innovative. So we've had a lot of bipartisan support for that now. We're up to 87 members in the caucus, and we have here in Northwest Oregon two nationally recognized STEAM schools, one in Hillsboro, one in Beaverton. Workforce development has been something that I've been working on when I visit businesses and when I talk with employers. There are oftentimes challenges finding people with the skills they need. So the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act passed a couple of years ago, and streamlining some of those workforce development programs and making them work better. One of the things that I'm very concerned about right now is the administration's proposed cuts to programs like the Senior Community Service Employment Program, the National Farm Workers Job Program, and the Job Corps Program, which is run through the Department of Labor. I'm speaking at a Job Corps graduation. Is that tomorrow? Tomorrow. And the Job Corps program, actually it's today. I'm speaking today at a speaking later today at it. Sarah's looking at me. No, that's today. At a Job Corps graduation, the Job Corps programs help at-risk students and get them skills that they need to join the workforce and be contributing members of the economy. So those are great programs, and those are on the chopping block in this administration. So the second issue I want to talk about, in addition to education, transportation and infrastructure. I'm very glad that our friends down in Salem passed a transportation bill. That's not, it's a great start, but we need to do that at the federal level as well. And Peterson's nodding her head. We need that federal investment in transportation and infrastructure. And we hear a lot of conversations. There seems to be broad bipartisan support for infrastructure investment. But there are two main challenges and two discussions we'll be having. One of them is, what does infrastructure mean? There are some narrow definitions of infrastructure. Is it roads and bridges? And there's some broader definitions of infrastructure, which I support. It also includes transit, water systems, dams. Can I mention Scoggins Dam in Washington County is an important infrastructure investment. When we look at what's happened across the country with lead in water, water systems, electric grids, there's a lot of infrastructure in this country that needs attention and investment. The second big issue is, how do we pay for it? Because our federal funding source, the Highway Trust Fund, relies on gas tax, and the federal gas tax has not been raised since the early 90s. Raising the federal gas tax has broad bipartisan support across the country, everywhere except in Congress. So we'll be having conversations about it's pretty true, so we'll be having conversations about how we fund infrastructure investment. There's discussions about public-private partnerships and finding the right balance there. There's always some public-private partnership with transportation and infrastructure investment, but what's the right balance, and does it overly favor urban as opposed to rural areas? And getting that balance right is going to be one of the challenges. And again, I'll mention an administration budget cut to the Tiger Grant program, which has been very helpful. Those grant programs that get local dollars, because we don't have earmarks in Congress. So when we pass a transportation bill, it's not like Salem where they pass a transportation bill and we know some of that money is going to 217. We don't have earmarks. So we have to find a way to get that over the finish line, but Tiger grants have been really helpful to get those local dollars to local projects. So the third big issue I wanted to mention that again came up in Allison's discussion about Legacy's work, especially with Central City Concern, is housing. And especially affordable housing, which we know is a challenge, not just in the metro area, but in rural Oregon as well. I hear about housing not just when I'm in the Portland part of the district, but in rural places in Washington County, over on the coast, Yamhill County. It is an issue that comes up everywhere. It's going to take, I'm glad there's so many local leaders here today and state leadership. It's going to take local, state, and federal support to address that issue. And part of it is, of course, growing the economy and getting more people into living wage jobs, but it also, there's a lot of policy that affects it too. I'm supporting the Affordable Housing Credit Improvement Act, which is kind of a long title, but it helps revise the eligibility requirements and helps get more housing projects into economically distressed areas. But one of the things we'll be talking about when we go back to Washington, D.C. is revenue reform. And if we don't have low-income housing tax credits, we aren't going to see the investment that we need. In fact, a lot of that is on hold right now because there is so much uncertainty. So I am going to emphasize the importance of letting your priorities be heard. Please let us know what your revenue reform priorities are as we enter into that process. The last time a comprehensive revenue reform package was passed was back in the late 80s, and Senator Packwood had a lot to do with that, our own Oregon senator, and there was a really solid bipartisan working group, and they, you know, put aside their differences and came together. And we're not seeing that with revenue reform right now, but I hope that we can. I'm an eternal optimist even in these hard times. I'm hoping that we can, because there really is a lot at stake for our country. So I am going to stop talking, and I know our legacy friends are going to monitor the questions, and we'll start.
Thank you. I happen to know that our esteemed Dr. George Brown has a question.
Thank you for the work that you do, Congresswoman Bonamici, and public education. I'm the product of public education and affordable college education, and I think it's eminently important for the future of this country. So please keep up your good work.
Thank you.
My question to you is, we've seen the roller coaster with the Affordable Care Act, repeal, replace. What's the next phase for that, in your opinion? Where are we going as a nation? As you might imagine, business requires a stable environment, and healthcare is a very large business. It's about 20% of the economy of most areas. And so we're waiting with bated breath for the next decision that Congress may make.
Thank you, Dr. Brown, and thank you for all your work. If I had a working crystal ball in this business, it would be really helpful. But I'll just start by emphasizing the importance of access to affordable health care, and say also, as you pointed out, the business of health care, I think a lot of that was lost in the discussion about the repeal-replace bill. It was an access to healthcare issue, but it was also a jobs issue, especially in our rural communities. If that the House bill had gotten over the finish line in the Senate, it would have been millions of people across the country losing access to coverage, but also a lot of jobs at stake. So we need to have that conversation as well. After the bill passed the House, which did not earn my support for many reasons, the Affordable Care Act was not in effect when I passed before I was in was in Congress. I was not there when it passed, but I certainly support access to affordable health care. Nobody thought it was perfect, and if we were doing things the Oregon way, we'd sit around a table and we'd say, what do we need to do to fix this? What do we need to do to expand access and reduce costs? We haven't had that conversation, and especially with a bill that went through the House, there weren't even any hearings. There were a couple of markups where amendments were offered in the middle of the night, but no hearings, no input from stakeholders, and just a vote on the floor. And as we know, the Senate version, also millions of people would have lost access, did not pass. Now, whether we go back, I know there are bipartisan conversations happening. Senator Alexander and Senator Murray are in the Senate working hard on some stabilization ideas. There are those efforts in the House as well to try to figure out what we can do to stabilize the markets. A lot of the uncertainty, you know, people are saying, oh, it's in a death spiral, and a lot of that is because of the uncertainty, because the insurance companies need to set their rates, and they don't know what Congress is going to do. So bringing some certainty is something, you know, a conversation that we need to have. And then just overall, you know, when I hear from people, this came up a lot in my spring series of town hall meetings. I had a 29-year-old woman in Portland stand up and say, I'm an architecture student. I have a bright career ahead of me. I'm really excited about my job prospects, but I was just diagnosed with MS, and I don't know what I'm going to do if this bill passes, because there's so much certainty about pre-existing conditions. I had the head of the Oregon Pediatric Association stand up, really distraught, because he said, I don't think people understand how many kids in this state get their coverage through Medicaid and get assistance in school through Medicaid. So people are really concerned about this. So is my commitment to do everything I can the first step is to stabilize the markets with those stabilization measures that are being discussed, and then to really have a meaningful discussion about how we make sure that people have access to affordable health care. There are many options out there. We need to have that conversation, but the first thing is stabilize the market and then have those conversations. So.
And we have a question over here.
Congresswoman Bonamici, Craig Dirksen, Metro Council.
Hi, Craig.
I appreciate your comments on infrastructure investment. Infrastructure, you said, what does that mean? What's a four-syllable word? That's hard. But Congress is going to be, in the near future, considering appropriations levels for Tiger grants, as you mentioned, and also capital grants. And I want to know if you could give us any insight into where your colleagues in Congress stand on that and what we can anticipate would come out of that. And assuming that there will be challenges there to see those programs adequately funded, what can we do and who can we talk to support Congress's appropriating the correct amount of money or a beneficial amount of money in those programs?
Thank you, Craig. And yes, what we're expecting when we go back in September is a sort of combination and expediting several appropriations bills. So we're in the amendment process right now and getting amendments into those on funding levels. I mean, we are already through the process of sending letters to the appropriators. We have some Northwest appropriators from Washington. Nobody from Oregon's on appropriations, but we have some Northwest support. So certainly know that I will advocate for those investments and know that it is important. I wanted to mention, because you mentioned Tiger grants, and I know how important Tiger grants have been to the area, and that they are completely eliminated in the administration's budget. I just want to remind everyone that we fortunately have three separate and independent branches of government. And so the administration's budget, the checks and balances are, you know, they're kind of working, and our founding fathers had some wisdom there. But so the president's budget is the administration's statement of values and priorities. It is not mine. It is not Oregon's. So as we go through that appropriations process, I will be speaking out for investments in transportation and infrastructure.
We have another question over here. Can you help me, Jonathan?
Hi, Suzanne. It's
Hi, nice
to
see
you this morning. Well, I'm out and about in the community. One of the key issues, especially among first responders, is mental health. And I'm wondering whether or not there's a comprehensive plan or a coalition that's being formed to kind of address this issue.
Well, thank you. And certainly there are many of my colleagues and I care deeply about access to mental health care and what we're doing about mental health care. You heard about the Unity Center, which has been, I was impressed with a number of people already who are finding assistance there, but we're not doing enough. Of course, with the Affordable Care Act, there's mental health components with access there, but we don't know, as Dr. Brown mentioned, we don't know what's going to happen with that. I strongly support taking steps on the opioid crisis, which isn't necessarily always related, but connected. There's so much we need to do to make sure that people have access to mental health care as well as health care. I supported years ago when we saw the deinstitutionalization and the movement to community-based mental health care, which is the right thing to do, but it needs to be funded. And it has not had mental health care and access to mental health care have not have had adequate funding. So it's part of the whole health care discussion, and many of us care deeply about it and will continue to advocate for steps, as well as working with our state and local partners. I know there's a wonderful walk in out in Washington County that recently opened, walk-in clinic, and having those opportunities available for people to get help when they need it. I'm also a big fan of school-based health centers, which is also really important for our students and access to that mental health care.
We have another question over here.
Hi, Mark. Nice to see you.
Good morning. Good to see you. Mark Sansusi, Beaverton City Council. You know, as the big debates about the major issues entertain us in the television and the other news, can you tell us a little bit about what kinds of bills are actually being passed by Congress while the larger storms are passing overhead?
I appreciate that question, and sometimes people say, you mean you actually get bills passed right now? Because There is a lot of conflict, and there's a lot of angst out there. Entertain was, an interesting word. I know people are anxious about what's happening at the federal level. So I feel like it's my responsibility as a representative for this district to continue to work on behalf of the district and get things done, despite the, you know, keeping track of all the investigations and staff changes and everything that's happening at the administration level. And I mentioned a couple things, the career and technical education bill that passed. I worked over the last several years on a Weather Forecasting Improvement Act and a Tsunami Warning Act. You know, I represent the North Coast, and I know improving tsunami warnings is important to the coastal areas, and improving weather forecasting is something that helps agriculture. It helps people who rely on the weather forecast for what they do with their business. So I worked on those for several years, strong bipartisan support. We got those over the finish line, and they were signed into law by this president in the first 100 days. That bill was among the 28 bills or so that were signed in the first 100 days. I did decline the offer for a bill signing, because I really didn't feel that was necessary. But the point is that we continue to do these things on behalf of our constituents that are important to the districts we represent and try to get things done. The bipartisan work study bill, for example. I have the bipartisan bill to help more students get into income-based repayment. They're sort of under the radar because there's so much going on at the administration level, and of course with the challenges. You know, we have the debt ceiling coming up. All the appropriations bills, if anybody saw the president's remarks the other night, he said he might be willing to shut down the government over the border wall. So I hope that doesn't happen. All I can say is I hope my colleagues say, you know, put their, you know, say this is unacceptable. We're not going to shut down the government over investing in a border wall. My colleagues who represent the border say, you know, maybe they need some more technology, some more staffing. Where there's a wall, there can be a wall. A lot of people who are undocumented in this country have overstayed their visas. You can build a wall a mile high. It doesn't solve the problem. So I hope we can get past that, continue to operate, not shut down the government over a border wall, and importantly, have a conversation about the need for comprehensive immigration reform, which this country desperately needs. Our Latina, Sheriff Garrett knows this, and others, our local leaders know, there's a lot of people in this community living in fear right now. I was down in Yamhill County, and must have been a 12 or 13-year-old boy came up to me, and sad look on his face. He said, "Can you please help me become a DACA early? I'm not old enough, but I really want to be a DACA so I can feel safer." I mean, when kids are afraid, it's unacceptable. So we have to have a conversation about comprehensive immigration reform. That was a really long answer to your question, but there are bills that are moving forward and passing. They're just not, with everything else that's happening, they're just not getting attention. Because there's so much else that's happening.
And Congresswoman, we have a question here.
Oh, so thank you. So let's talk about transportation, not to pile on, but from a little different angle perhaps, and that is, and you alluded to in your opening comments with regard to a P3, but where there may be a leverage with the administration is to have an influx of for-profit dollars into our transportation system. And as Lynn pointed out, and as you know, we have the opening opportunity for that in the ability to charge now fees for access, which is a critical component to the P3 concept. What in your mind, and perhaps speaking on for your colleagues in Washington, are the issues of the balance you talked about, and what is sort of the pro and con push-pull between supporting for-profit investment
right.
and keeping that out?
Right. I think the concern, thank you, Mayor, I think the primary concern that I've heard from colleagues is urban-rural, that it pencils out for the investment in urban areas, but not as much, if at all, in rural areas. And so my colleagues who represent rural areas, I have a lot of rural areas in my district, and I appreciate that about the district I represent. You know, some of my colleagues, like in New York, for example, it's all urban. Their whole district is, you know, a few vertical blocks. So they only look at things from an urban perspective. And I have, you know, colleagues who represent mostly rural areas, but I have both. So I keep that in mind. If all of the investments are going into urban areas, maybe that's where the need is. If you get the balance right to make sure that rural communities get the infrastructure investment they need as well, that's where, you know, it's finding the right balance.
Any philosophical pushbacks? I hear the objections of private industry should be involved in something that's a utility.
Well, of course there will be some people expressing that. There are a lot of places where public-private partnerships make sense. The weather forecasting bill, for example, has some great provisions about working with private satellite companies. So there are a lot of opportunities to have public-private partnerships. It's getting the right balance. So yeah, there will be some pushback, but again, balance.
Hello. Thank
Hi.
You for
nice to see you.
All the work that you do. Could you speak a little bit more? You talked a little bit about climate change and science. Can you speak a little bit more about what you're doing to ensure that sustainable environmental regulation stays around, as well as the proper use of science and policymaking?
Right. Thank you. Well, there's a lot of defense right now on the science committee with the new EPA administrator. Administrator Pruitt was the Attorney General of Oklahoma. He testified before the committee, and he will say that he believes in clean air and clean water. He just thinks it should be done by the states. But as we know, emissions and pollution don't recognize state boundaries or international boundaries. It's going to take a national and international approach. So when the president, for example, announced that he's going to withdraw the United States from the Paris Accord, putting us there with a Nicaragua who isn't in because it didn't go far enough, and Syria is not in because they're in the middle of a civil war, I of course spoke out and you know, called on the administration to reconsider that opinion. That doesn't happen right away, so I know many of us will be encouraging the administration to reconsider that position. I applaud our local and business leadership. A lot of our local businesses spoke up and said, look, we're going to do our part to reduce emissions. And certainly in the committee, when we have hearings, trying to make sure that we get the very best witnesses. We just had Dr. Wahlbusser from Oregon State come and talk to the Climate Solutions Caucus about ocean acidification. I'm also co-chairing the Oceans Caucus with Representative Don Young from Alaska. So in that work, making sure that we're addressing issues of ocean health. So taking every opportunity I can to talk about why we need to address climate change and how it's affecting our businesses and our economy. But in terms of policy, very little is getting done right now. I did mention the amendment that did not pass that would have taken the language out of the defense bill. So just being a voice and trying to do what I can to raise awareness among my colleagues. And we are making progress. And you know, over the past several years, we've seen, for example, the creation of the Bipartisan Climate Solutions Caucus, more members joining, more members understanding as they see the effects in the businesses in their industry. You know, I was touring a business, what happened to Mayor Doyle? Is he still here? So Mayor Doyle, I was touring a business in Beaverton a while back. They used to sell a lot of snowboards, and now they're mostly selling skateboards. Anyway, you talk to, you know, industries like Columbia, you know, they're not selling their big coats when it's not cold, and our outdoor recreation industries are affected. Our agriculture industries are affected. So this is something that's a serious issue for our state, for our country, and for our planet. So being as much of a voice as I can to educate my colleagues, and we hope to start passing some policy and you know, opposing the cuts to the EPA. There's some pretty devastating cuts to some of these agencies, and I just want to mention how one place where the cuts are seriously concern me are in the State Department. We have a lot of open positions in the State Department. It took a very long time even for a Deputy Secretary of State to be confirmed. And when we need diplomacy now more than ever, to have so many open positions and so many people have left and taking with them their expertise and their experience with diplomacy, and that's a serious concern, as well as cuts to the EPA and people leaving the EPA and not being able to stay in an administration that doesn't value the work of the agency. So, hi,
nice Congressman Jerry Milner from Portland State. The United States has one of the highest business income tax rates of any industrialized country. The Speaker has put tax reform as one of his top priorities. If he fails to get his entire caucus, what kind of features of tax reform would be required for you to support a tax reform bill?
Thank you. And in a broad sense, is certainly tax reform would be a good thing to do. I don't know anybody who likes the tax code the way it is, but it's making sure that it's a progressive, not progressive like liberal, but progressive, not regressive. I would be very concerned if a tax reform bill eliminated safety net services, and of course, if the rate is lowered, then what's making up for where will the cuts be? Where will the revenue be? I know that the administration is relying on this very bold, overly optimistic view of economic growth with their cuts. It doesn't seem realistic to me, so I would want to make sure that if there are those reductions in rates, is it more leveling the playing field and getting rid of some of the loopholes? Because, you know, the effective rate that corporations pay is not the statutory rate, because there's so many exceptions and alternatives and loopholes and things that are used. So making sure that it is a tax code that protects the safety net. And there certainly I've heard from many of people in Oregon about their priorities. I mentioned the low-income housing tax credit is one example. Tax-exempt municipal bonds, I've heard that from a few of our local leaders. I mean, there are these tax policies that really make a difference in economic growth at our local level. So I would want to see that comprehensively. I've been concerned about sort of piecemeal tax reform. For example, you know, people will bring forward a bill and say, we need to preserve the charitable deduction. I think that's a good thing, but if you just preserve the charitable deduction, then where's everything else? So ideally, in a perfect world, we would do comprehensive tax reform, and you know, if you're preserving charitable deduction, then what else is on the table? So, but in general, a progressive, not regressive, to make sure that our essential safety net services are supported, and to make sure that wherever the difference is in what we're losing in revenue is not at the expense of hardworking families. And there's still, you know, many people who are struggling and people who are in need of those safety net services that help them get back on their feet. I was up at talking with some folks in Columbia County with their community action team, and there was this great story of this woman who, you know, her family just fell on some really hard times, and she said, "I really appreciated the help from the food bank and some housing assistance and getting me back on my feet." And now she said, "I am so proud right now that I don't need those services anymore." But to get her family through, she did. And if we get rid of those services, what does that do to our community? So.
Good morning, Congresswoman.
Hi, Commissioner. Nice to see you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for giving us of your time. I would like to go back to your transportation, visit that just for a minute.
I think transportation is pretty important to Washington County.
It's a great subject. But, you know, one of the things we here in Oregon have to do is look at how our land use planning is being handled today. We cannot put multimodal transportation, nor automobile and commercial transportation, through rural areas. And cutting across Washington County, for certain, there are areas we do need to put new transportation through that we cannot do today. You can't continue crowding it onto 217 and other corridors such as that. So your support within our legislature and all of us in this room in that regards would help us a lot.
I appreciate that. Thank you. And of course, that land use issues are state and local, but wherever if there's a federal barrier, like I mentioned to Lynn, if there's a federal barrier in the way, I want to know what I can do to be helpful and you know, helping those things get through. We were up in Columbia County, and they're building a new senior center, and there was this federal regulation that just wasn't making any sense. So if people bring those to our attention, we'll do what we can to remove those barriers.
Well, thank you very, very much. I think that is the last question.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.